As of writing this paragraph, it is July 12th. That makes yesterday July 11th. On July 11th, the following two things occurred. The first, on Square Enix's official US store page, the complete edition of Final Fantasy XIV sold out. You could purchase the base game and Shadowbringers separate just fine, but the code for the complete edition sold out. Purchase button was replaced with a waitlist button instead. Clicking it asked for your email to be told when codes came in. And as a side note, running out of digital codes isn't as stupid as it sounds. It's an anti-fraud method, and it's especially expected when you consider the rest of the evidence. Last night, multiple people began to post pictures of server statuses. All three US data centers were completely locked down. No character creation allowed anywhere. This piece of evidence alone wouldn't be anything by itself. We're in the middle of a free login campaign, so that could be the cause. But free login players aren't buying the complete edition of Final Fantasy XIV. They'd buy Shadowbringers or Endwalker. Thirdly, there is the experience I had July 6th. I've been trying to do a special little project of comparing Palace of the Dead leveling to dungeon leveling, queue times included. While doing the 1-15 leveling before dungeons became available, I saw a lot of players in the overworld. Sure, you might normally see one or two people in Central Shroud. Instead, I saw a good number of them across the entire zone. That was before the login campaign too. There was also a number of people in Eastern Shroud and Northern Shroud, and this was midday on a Tuesday from about 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. Eastern, not peak hours. The following picture was taken at 12:38 p.m. Eastern, according to my PC clock. The specific servers locked down are fluctuating minute to minute, but there's many being locked. European servers are also almost all locked down, but they are currently in peak hours as of that time. And the complete edition is still on waiting list. Which, sure, it's Monday. Work week just started. Novice Network is capped out constantly. 100 mentors, 412 novices. Complain about the system all you want, this isn't the place for it. Fact is, even that is filled every day, when normally it's a bit lower. We're also learning that free trial players are actually being blocked from logging in. Servers are so congested, paid players are blocking free trials from even being in queue to log in. So any idea that this is just a boost of free trial players is even more completely off base as well. Now fast forward to the new date, the 19th. The Golden Saucer's Make It Rain campaign just started. Leap of Faith has queue times, something they never had before, not even during Make It Rain 2020. You can barely see yourself in any of the events. Point is, the game's hitting a period of major popularity. All of this leading to what I call the Asmund effect. He's hardly the only one who's abandoning ship in any sense of the word. WoW refugees are coming over en masse without any big streamers. They all say the same about how bad the game is right now, etc, etc. But that's not the point. Not the why, but the fact that they are coming over at all. Queue times are fluctuating all over the place, even for tanks and sometimes healers. Overworld zones are populated again. Towns are more active than ever. All the elements have come together at once to be a very active time to the game. A lot has been made about Asmund and what effect he has on the game. Many were afraid he'd make the game more toxic. And they were right. See how many people got banned because they were harassing him? Game got more toxic. Now, obviously I'm making a joke there, but I'm also not. Many people have seen how his chat acts sometimes, and how his Asmund character acts, crude, often outright offensive, even when out of character as well. But what we really should have focused on is the sheer number of people he would bring along. He himself is one person, but he brings a powerful influence. Day one or so, obviously things would get flooded with people trying to follow him, but eventually things would peter out as he outpaces them. And of course, some of them got banned. But many of them stay, and many of them have stayed, and many more are on their way. And so remains the question of how big of a bump is this going to be? How many are truly going to stick around? There's always the chance things mostly peter out and overall the boost isn't that big, but that the complete edition sold out is a different story, I'd say. That's something a player who is ready to be in for the long haul is going to buy. You won't be buying the complete edition if you get to level 30, aren't really feeling it, and might quit. You might hold out for longer before you buy it. That, or you just have money to burn. I think there's going to be a permanent boost to the player base, so long as the dev team for 14 continues to do a good job like they always have been, and doesn't lose their current player base. Endwalker is going to be a massive popularity spike for the game. I believe at the 14-hour broadcast's live letter, they mentioned that Endwalker has 3 times the number of pre-orders as Shadowbringers had. It's only been a few weeks so far that this major spike has occurred, so I really wonder how far are the effects going to go. Tank queues are even taking long. Are queues going to even out as more players get further places in the game? Because before this, DPS queues were a lot shorter than they are now, tanks were all but instant, and then we have to deal with Reaper coming out with Endwalker. I'm sure a lot of people will want to play with that, so DPS will be heavily weighted even more than normal. Will queues recover before this? Or will it last the next 4 months and into Endwalker? How many more people are going to come over from WoW or other games, or just start the game from no background? Though I mean, queue times are a small time worry compared to what the actual effect on it has to the game. More players, more experiences, more everything. And more profits for the company could mean more content or staff. Higher quality content and such. I mean, look at what they just did otherwise with the kind of popularity the game has with Shadowbringers before all of this. An entire data center in Australia for Oceana servers. A project they say cost millions. That kind of investment says they're going to try and expand in other ways too. An extra boost in popularity like this brings will only lead to even more, bigger, and better things. At worst, I think we're going to see a lot of server upgrades besides the Australian servers. Given everything else I talked about so far, we need more servers. This is post-expansion as far as the Final Fantasy XIV cycle goes. Shadowbringers is over. We're in the most dead part of any expansion cycle, and yet this is possibly the most active the game has been ever, if not since Shadowbringers launch. If we're going to survive Endwalker, more servers need to be rushed into use, or the end of days for the servers is what we'll be seeing. This also goes back to how Yoshida has always been. Back in 2.0's launch, the servers kind of exploded. He did not expect such a huge player base when the game returned. He and the dev spent a long time just focusing on work to fix the servers instead of enjoying good reviews or such and having a good time. This is going to be a repeat of that moment for the devs, and I'm not the only person that feels that way. They're going to be happy the popularity is here, but they're also going to be worried about the state of the servers. Besides free trial players being locked out, there is a level of server instability, and people being able to play the game at all is paramount to them. This will be a period of tremendous work for the team, on top of already trying to get Endwalker finished. But I also want to make a note of other effects we're seeing. I've been hearing many tales of wipes and Crystal Tower raids. More than usual, at least. A side effect of the tons of new players we are getting, I am sure. We're going to see a lot of wipes due to just how many new players we have. Not just inexperienced or less knowledgeable compared to a veteran, outright new players. It's up to everyone else to be teaching people mechanics more than they normally have to. not everything will be as visceral as it normally is to you. You might be the only person who has done a fight pretty often now, and that's not just for the easy stuff. After seeing Asmund do it, there's been an influx of players attempting to do extreme level content, many even going as far as to do, as Asmund is doing, minimum item level. Perhaps we will eventually see players trying much harder in the future to learn mechanics better, study them more closely, and even improve their own skills. People willing to listen and aim to do better is always a good thing. You really can't find any way it isn't. People doing harder content is also good, especially if they learn from it. There's a lot to love in this game, and people should be open to attempting it and improving from all of it. These are the kind of effects we want to see in the game. And say what you want about Asmund, like him, hate him, whatever. Everyone is going to have their opinions on him as a person or whether he himself being in the game is a good thing. It's clear the dude is enjoying himself with the game. Maybe the game will even change him in a way that people don't expect. Less toxic or more accepting of others or other such. But no matter what, the effect on the game as a whole seems like it will be pretty clear. This is an overall good for the game, and I look forward to seeing what comes out of it from a developer aspect and player aspect. I just wanted to give my thoughts on something I noticed going on. To me, the clear answer is to brace for impact of player count, for better or for worse. Endwalker is going to be more popular than ever. There's going to be more people showing up, and Asmund isn't going anywhere unless he decides to. The people who thought they could run him off were very lacking in self-awareness, but I digress. Be the change you want to see in the game. Don't just complain about it. And take care, and may the power of Anandid Hogsley waste to your enemies. And an extra special thanks to all my patrons over on Patreon. And an extra special thanks to Ayadeva, Ayman Al-Khatib, Benjamin Hahn, Body Clock, Ethan Olsen, Evan, Kyle Steinhauser, Lise, Meowfie, Mizella, Scott Stanley, Valor LLC, and Yvonne the Moose. Thank you all for watching, thank you all for your support, see you next time.